Hi everyone and welcome to another video. It's been really busy recently, so unfortunately it took me quite some time since the last upload. In this video, I'm starting with an HP ProDesk G6 SFF, which at first glance looks just a bit dusty, but that turned out quite different as you will see. In my previous video, we had a better look at the tower variant of this machine, so for sure you should check that out later if you're interested. As mentioned, when I got the machine, it was pretty dusty, so first thing I want to do is to clean it. I'm opening the small case, which can easily be done by releasing the thumb screw in the back and getting the cover off. After removing most of the dust on the outside also deserves some much needed cleaning. There we go, that looks almost like new. This should be quick. Or at least that's what I thought. When testing the PC, not much seems to happen when trying to turn it on. As soon as the power is connected, the fan in the power supply is spinning, but nothing more is happening when pushing the power button. To troubleshoot this issue, I'll remove what we don't really need to make it easier. I'm getting rid of the DVD drive. And also the M2 SSD on the board. That didn't seem to help, apparently. We have the power supply, motherboard, CPU and memory left. And since the CPU and memory are fully compatible with the G6 micro tower, which I mentioned in the beginning, I decided to swap these and see what we get. The G6 MT had an i7-9700 and 16 gigs of RAM. The broken SFF came with an i5-9500 and 8 gigabytes. With the working i7 and 16 GB in the broken machine, the result stays the same, unfortunately. That already suggests that the CPU and memory are probably not the cause of the issue. To be sure, we can test them in the working motherboard of the G6 MT. That's already a good sign, since we have output, and this warning is completely expected. Windows seems to boot fine as well. And as you can see, the i5-9500 and 8 GB of memory are working. Somehow, I don't have this recording anymore, but I also tried the power supply swap with success. This means that we tested 3 of the 4 remaining components as working. As a result, at this stage, I'm pretty sure that the problem is with the motherboard. To have a better look at it and to test if there are no shorts with the case, we need to remove it from there. Well, that explains a lot. That doesn't look good at all. Not sure which kind of fluid this is, not sure I even want to know, but it definitely caused the issues we have. There is some serious damage over here under the PCIe slots. And over here, well, on the complete right side as well actually. I will do an attempt at removing the fluid and it remains using isopropyl alcohol, but honestly, I don't really believe this can be saved. At least it's worth a try. I'm starting with the case first. Then it's time to do the same with the motherboard. This looks a lot better, but I'm afraid the damage is too severe. Especially this place here under the PCIe X16 slot bothers me a lot. Let's put the minimal config back in the case to see if the cleaning helped. And it did not, as we kind of expected. At least we know now that the CPU and memory are fine, so I basically had two options at this point. Either I could buy a new motherboard that fits in this case, so the exact same HP model in other words, or buy another case and motherboard and reuse the CPU, memory and SSD. I like the first idea the most, but after looking around on the internet, what I found either didn't ship to Belgium or was priced too high. So instead, I got a new case and motherboard and the power supply and DVD I still had laying around. For the motherboard, I chose for a Biostar B365 MHC, which, as the name suggests, comes with the Intel B365 chipset. In the box, we have a manual, backplate and two SATA cables, which come in handy. The main reason for this choice is the support for our 9th gen Intel Core CPU, ATX and a 4-pin power connector, not 8-pin, and an M.2 slot. Altogether, we have the motherboard, DVD drive, cooler, memory, SSD and the i5-9500 CPU. That's the one which we will start with and get in the socket of the motherboard. After some fresh thermal paste, we can install the CPU cooler. Since in the HP case, the cooler was fixed to the chassis and the motherboard does not have a backplate, I had to work around that and fix the cooler using bolts instead. That really tested my patience, but worked eventually. Then we can put in the 8GB of DDR4, and the M.2 NVMe drive. After fixing the board to the new case, we can insert the power supply and connect it. The next part is the most annoying, those small case connectors. Always a fun job. Last one is the DVD drive. There we go, that looks pretty clean if you ask me. One small thing that bothered me is the lack of feet on the case, so I'll quickly put some rubber feet on it before we go on. Let's see if all of this is working. First sign is good, as we have something on the screen. The BIOS shows the 8GB of memory, and detected the CPU as expected. Less good is that the SSD in the M.2 drive is not seen. Neither is it under the NVMe drives. I've had before that an NVMe drive was not seen in the BIOS, but it was still working. So I'm booting off a Windows 11 installation USB to see if it detects the NVMe drive over there. In a command prompt with disk part, let me see which drives are detected. Only the USB drive, unfortunately. Either this motherboard is not compatible with that NVMe drive, but as far as I know, it should be supported, or it is broken. After all, NVMe connects to PCIe, and that was an area on the broken motherboard that was severely damaged. So it's really not unlikely that the NVMe drive got faulty in all of this. I have another M.2 drive laying around. That one is only 128GB and SATA instead of NVMe. As you can see, these both have the M2 form factor and use the same slot, but the key is different. Okay, next attempt. This time we can see the M2 drive in the BIOS, that's good. And as this is a SATA drive, it's expected to not see it with the NVMe option. All seems to be working and Windows 11 is booting fine. We could go now to the part where I'm testing stuff, but I figured since we have a bigger case now, we might as well do something more fun. So I came up with the following. Here we have an additional 1TB drive and SATA cable to compensate for the smaller SSD. But more exciting is this Zotac GTX 980, which comes with two 6-pin PCIe connectors, hence the additional cable. The GTX 980 is almost 8 years old now, but still outperforms some of the newer cards like a GeForce RTX 3050 Ti, for example. I'm curious to see how this one will do. Let's get these parts installed, starting with the hard disk. Then, in preparation for the GTX 980, we need to get an additional 6-pin PCIe connector, next to the one that comes directly from the power supply. Those two connectors are needed as the GTX 980 can theoretically draw up to 275 watts. The power supply is 450 watts, so that should be fine. Let's make place for the not so small card now and get it installed. There we go, isn't that just pretty? The BIOS showed the 1TB drive, that's good. We can see that the drivers for the video card are missing, but I came prepared and installed them first thing. Let's have a look now at what the software tells us. About this PC shows us the i5-9500 and 8GB of RAM completely as expected. In Task Manager, we can see the same, including the GPU. Time for some benchmarking, starting with Geekbench 5. $3,470 is not amazing, but in line with what is to be expected with this CPU. Next benchmark is the compute benchmark of Geekbench 5. Here I expect something better. $33,338. Not bad, not bad. Only system I tested that performed better had the GTX 1070 Ti, but other than that, the GTX 980 clearly still does a good job. For disk performance, I will use AGA system test. As expected, the SSD, although M2, is a SATA SSD, so performance is not amazing. For completeness, I'll also test the 1TB hard disk. These numbers are pretty good for a mechanical drive. Last test is 3D Mark. $4,200 is a pretty good score, considering this machine has an 8-year-old GPU. For example, the median PC I repaired earlier, which had a GTX 960, got around $2,300, while the CPU got a similar score as this one in Geekbench. The Dell Inspiron laptop with a 1050 Ti got around $2,500 with a faster CPU. That's it for this video. No time for more, as I really want to check out the game performance now. Glad at least I could save some components from that broken HP. Thanks a lot for watching. I hope you enjoyed this, and if you did, please put a thumbs up and consider subscribing. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.